get started with the foundations of convective heat transfer, the mathematical foundations of convective heat transfer. Now, the mathematical foundations of convective heat transfer strongly depend on fluid mechanics, and this is so because convection may be fundamentally perceived as advection assisted conduction. So, you have a situation where conduction is a must, but that is assisted by something which is advection or transport of heat by fluid flow. So, to get a physical picture of why fluid flow is important for heat transfer, let us consider a situation like this. Let us say that you have a solid boundary and fluid is coming from first stream with a velocity u infinity and temperature T infinity. Now, to write what is the heat transfer at the wall, we express it by this following boundary condition. We have discussed earlier that this boundary condition is valid for both steady state and unsteady state, and only important assumption is that radiation is neglected. Otherwise, there will be a radiation term along with it. Now, in convective heat transfer, we are mainly interested to find out what is H. If we know what is H, then we know what is the rate at which heat is being transferred at the wall, right? The question is, H will depend on what? What are the parameters on which H will depend? So, you can, of course, non-dimensionalize this equation and write, if you define a non-dimensional theta, non-dimensional temperature theta, and non-dimensional y, y by L, then you can write this equation . So what you get is a non-dimensional temperature gradient at the wall. Because this is non-dimensional, this is also a non-dimensional parameter which is known as Nusselt number. It is very important to understand that there is a fundamental difference between this Nusselt number and the Biot number that we have talked about in conduction heat transfer. We will come into that. Now, we will see what are the parameters on which we depend and we will bring a context by virtue of which we will understand that how fluid mechanics relates to heat transfer. So, my first question is, what is this K? Is this K of solid or K of fluid? Okay, this is my first question. Is this K of solid or you have a solid wall and you have a fluid at the top of it? So, this is K of solid or K of fluid? So, sometimes as I often discuss that these days it is easier to get an answer if we pose it in multiple choice mode, right? Right. Number 1, K of solid. Number 2, K of fluid. Number 3, either K of solid or K of fluid. Number 4, none of the above we cannot say. So, 3 choices. K of solid, K of fluid, K of solid or K of fluid. Let us see. So, I am just enlarging the solid boundary, solid wall. This is the solid wall. Okay. Let us say that this temperature is T wall, which may be a function of x. X is this is x axis. T wall may itself be a function of x, may not be a function of x. So, if this is T wall, let us take an example that T wall is greater than T infinity. I mean, we can take two interesting examples. One is T wall greater than T infinity, another is T wall less than T infinity. T wall equal to T infinity is a redundant example because then there is no temperature difference between the wall and the fluid. So, let us say this temperature is T1. If it is steady state, what will be the temperature profile between T1 and T wall? Linear temperature profile, right? So, let us draw it with some color. What will be the temperature profile in the fluid? In general, not linear. If it is a system where there is only conduction, that means the fluid is stagnant, then it may be possible that the temperature profile in the fluid is also linear, but in general it is not so. So, let us say that the temperature profile in the fluid is something like this. Okay. So, importantly, what is common at the interface? What is continuous at the interface between the solid and the fluid? Number 1, temperature is continuous, right? Temperature, because at a given point you cannot have two different temperatures, one in the fluid and one in the solid, right? So, at a given point you must have unique temperature. So, there must be continuity of temperature. And the second, the heat flux must be continuous. The rate at which heat is transferred from the solid to the fluid here is the same rate at which heat leaves to the fluid. The reason is that this is an interface. Interface doesn't have any thermal storage capacity. So, whatever heat comes at the interface, at the same rate it will leave. So, what is the rate at which heat is coming at the interface? Minus K F for solid. We will use F for solid and F for fluid. This is the rate at which this temperature profile, this is Ts, and this temperature profile is Ts. Okay. So this is equal to the heat flux at the wall. Wall means interface, not the bottom at this location. This is equal to H into T wall minus T infinity. This is nothing but the so called Newton's law of cooling. Okay. So this is always valid except when radiation is present, a radiation heat flux has to be added. Now, based on this, can you give an answer that whether it is K of solid or K of fluid? Yes? See, it all depends on whether you are using the temperature profile of the solid or temperature profile of the fluid. If here you are using temperature profile of the solid, then this will be K of solid. If here you are using temperature profile of fluid, it will be K of fluid. But in convective heat transfer, our interest of domain is the fluid domain. Therefore, we are interested to find out the temperature profile in the fluid and the temperature gradient in the fluid profile. So, if we are interested to do that, that means this is K of fluid. But fundamentally, there is no restriction that it will be K of fluid. It depends on it is T of what. If it is T within the solid, then this is K of solid. If this is T within the fluid, it will be K of fluid. Okay. And you can see here that because in general Ks and Kf are different, therefore the slopes of these two lines are different. They are not, these two lines have same unique value at their points of intersection, but they do not have the same slope because Ks and KL, Kf are in general different. Okay. So, important thing is that if this theta is theta of the fluid, now we write here theta of the fluid, then this is K of fluid. So, non-dimensional temperature gradient of the temperature profile within the fluid is equal to HL by K of fluid. In the Bayou number definition, the K was K of solid, and in the Nusselt number definition, K is K of fluid. Okay. So, typically, we can say that Nusselt number is therefore a representation of non-dimensional temperature gradient in the fluid at the interface between the fluid and the solid. So, it will depend on what? Intuitively, the Nusselt number will be a function of these are the parameters, like out of these, what are the fluid mechanics parameters? The fluid mechanics parameters are rho, u infinity, L and mu. And we will discuss about these parameters, why these parameters are important. And the non-fluid mechanics parameters are K, Cp and partly rho also. Rho partly contributes to the fluid dynamics parameters and partly contributes to the thermal parameters. So, the question is that why these parameters are important? These parameters are important because of the following reason. Let us take an example. Let me ask you a question. If u infinity is increased, do you expect a higher heat flux at the wall or lower heat flux at the wall? Question is, if you increase U infinity, do you expect a higher heat flux at the wall or lower heat flux at the wall? You expect a higher heat flux at the wall. The reason is like this. See, what is happening? With a higher U infinity, there is a higher rate at which heat is getting transferred by fluid flow. To compensate for that, to replenish that, more heat is to be supplied from the wall. So let us say that there is some person who is a voracious eater, who always eats, and after eating the person becomes more and more hungry, like a diabetic patient. So then, to make that person happy, you have to supply more food. Otherwise, that person will not feel happy. So this is something like this. So the fluid flow is carrying heat at a very fast rate. So to make up for that, more heat has to be supplied from the wall, right? So that is one of the very important parameters. Then the other parameter, L is of course important because the entire characteristic length scale of the problem is governed by the length L. Mu and rho, the combination of mu and rho, what does it play a role? So it is essentially not mu or rho individually, but mu by rho, which is known as kinematic viscosity. Now question is, why mu by rho is important? Why not mu individually or why not rho individually? So what does mu do? If you think of this physical problem, let us draw a separate sketch here. Let us say this is the wall. Molecules which are adhering to the wall will directly feel the effect of the wall. So, if the molecules are significantly compact, then they are almost like trapped by the attractive interactions of the wall and they cannot escape from the wall. This in fluid mechanics, in classical fluid mechanics, is known as no slip boundary condition. So that there is no relative tangential component of velocity between the fluid and the solid boundary. Of course, there are many situations in microfluidics and nanofluidics where this no slip boundary condition is violated, but we will not discuss about that in the basic course. So let us say that there is a situation when the no slip boundary condition is valid and the molecules are sticking to the wall. Now, these molecules are sticking to the wall because they directly understand that there is a wall. Now consider the second layer of molecules on the top of these ones. The second layer of molecules, what happens to them? Does the second layer of molecule move with a velocity u infinity? No, it moves with a velocity much slower than u infinity, but not zero. So it moves with a velocity which is much slower than u infinity, but faster than this. That means, why it is not moving at a velocity u infinity? Because it understands that there is a wall. How does it understand that there is a wall? It is not in direct contact with the wall. So how does it understand that there is a wall? There is a messenger in the fluid that propagates the message that yes, there is a momentum disturbance. And that messenger in the fluid is nothing but viscosity of the fluid. So viscosity of the fluid is physically a messenger for momentum disturbance. It gives a message that there is a momentum disturbance in the fluid. Now, the fluid gets a message that there is a momentum disturbance, but the fluid has its own inertia. So even though there is a momentum disturbance, the fluid intends or tends to maintain its own momentum. By virtue of which property of the fluid? By virtue of inertia of the fluid. By virtue of inertia of the fluid tends to sustain its momentum. And inertia of the fluid is proportional to the mass, and mass is proportional to the density. So, mu is the tendency of the fluid to have to undergo a change in momentum or disturbance in momentum, and rho is the tendency to sustain the momentum. So, this is a relative ability of change of momentum with respect to the tendency to sustain its momentum. And that is why it is important as a basic feature. And you know, it is very interesting that there are different types of fluids which grossly vary in mu and rho, but in terms of the property mu by rho, there are many apparently different types of fluids which have close value of the kinematic viscosity. If you go to steel plant, you will find that there is flow of molten steel in steel plant. Now, to understand the fluid mechanics of molten steel, many times in the R&D divisions of steel plants, what they do is they make water models. That is, instead of studying the behavior of steel, they are studying the behavior of water in a transparent box. Now, the question is that why it is being done like that? Of course, the practical constraint is that molten metal flow at a very high temperature, it is very hazardous to deal with, it is very hazardous to handle. So, it is very difficult to do fluid mechanics experiments by visualizing that. Not only that, molten metals, most of the cases, they are not transparent medium. So, you cannot visualize the flow. So, there are practical reasons. But the question is that when you cannot visualize molten metal, how can you replace water with molten steel? One of the basic reasons is that typically mu of steel is roughly 10 times mu of water, roughly one order, and rho of steel is also roughly one order more than that of water, right? So, mu by rho of steel is mu by rho of water. So, this is very remarkable behavior that although density and viscosities of water and steel are grossly varying, but kinematic viscosity of water and kinematic viscosity of steel are roughly very similar. Now, that makes water models work, but only when heat transfer effect is not very important. When heat transfer effect is important, you also have to consider the thermal diffusivity, and thermal diffusivity of steel and water are grossly different. So, when heat transfer effects are very important, just by this similarity, you cannot say that whatever will happen for molten steel will be the same with water, because the thermal diffusivity wise, they are different. But purely from fluid mechanics considerations, this is the similarity. Now, we have to understand that what will be the role of this mu. That is, if you increase this mu, what will be the wall heat flux? Will it increase or decrease? See, what we are trying to do, we are trying to understand physically first the influence of fluid mechanics parameters on heat transfer, because that will give us a motivation of why should we study fluid flow equations in the context of heat transfer. In the context of fluid mechanics, we study fluid flow equations fine, but why in the context of heat transfer we should study fluid flow equations? So, U infinity role we have understood. So, now we have coupled these two and we are trying to see that what is the role of this mu. Now, if mu is high, what will happen? See, mu will dictate that how far from the wall you should go to achieve, to attain U infinity. The distance from the wall that you go to attain close to U infinity, that is known as the boundary layer thickness. Right? So, boundary layer thickness can be anything from very small to very large. So, the question is that when nu is increased, then what do you expect the boundary layer thickness to be, large or small? If nu is large, that means what is the, if nu is increased, then what is the distance up to which the wall effect is felt? The distance is more, right? So, more and more fluid understands the effect of the wall if the fluid has higher kinematic viscosity, because the momentum disturbance is very strong. So, if that means the, if nu is large, then the boundary layer thickness is large. If the boundary layer thickness is large, what is the velocity gradient within the boundary layer? If the boundary layer thickness is large, then the velocity gradient within the boundary layer for a given u infinity is small, right? Now, it can be shown that if we consider, so this is related to velocity gradient, we will discuss about velocity gradients later, but similar to the boundary layer within which the velocity gradient occurs, there is a boundary layer within which the temperature gradient also occurs. That is known as thermal boundary layer. So, in the thermal boundary layer, the temperature will change from T wall to T infinity. Let the thickness of the thermal boundary layer be delta T. So, delta by delta T . What is delta related to? Delta is related to the kinematic viscosity of the fluid. Similarly, from analogy, can you say what is delta T related to? Thermal diffusivity of the fluid, right? Kinematic viscosity and thermal diffusivity are very similar parameters. Thermal diffusivity is what? Thermal diffusivity is K by rho Cp. K is just like mu by rho. Mu is momentum disturbance and rho is momentum sustenance. Similarly, K by rho Cp, K is thermal disturbance due to conduction and rho Cp is the ability for thermal storage or thermal, this, that is thermal inertia. Okay. So, very similar. So, nu by alpha is related to delta by delta T. And this nu by alpha is a parameter known as Prandtl number. So, for a given alpha, if you have higher nu, you have higher delta, right? So, if you have higher delta, because of Prandtl number is a property of the fluid, you should also have higher delta T, because delta by delta T is fixed for a given fluid. So, if you have a higher value of delta T, then what will happen? If you have higher value of nu, you will have higher value of delta T. If you have higher value of delta T, then what is the temperature gradient within the thermal boundary layer? Is it more or less? Remember that we are essentially interested about the temperature gradient. So, what is roughly the temperature gradient within the thermal boundary layer? T infinity, T wall minus T infinity by delta T, roughly. If it was linear, this is just order of magnitude. Okay. So, this is roughly del T del Y at the wall, order of magnitude. Okay. So if you have higher delta T, you will have lower heat flux. Right? That means the Nusselt number will be low. Right? So you can see, we started with mu, we came with heat flux, something very non-intuitive, right? We started with a pure fluid mechanics parameter and we came up with a increase of mu will have a decrease of heat flux. That means decrease of mu will have an increase of heat flux. So decrease of mu and increase of u infinity and also increase of L are of same effect. So the net effect is of increase of u infinity L by mu. If you increase u infinity, the effect is like decrease of mu and increase of L. And this together as a combination is Reynolds number that all of you know, right? So the Nusselt number for forced convection will be a function of Reynolds number and this parameter Prandtl number, right? I just tried to give you a pure physical argument without getting into any mathematics, just simple physical argument. But this kind of physical argument is very important because we should first develop a motivation of why are we interested to go through the fluid mechanics equations to understand convection. So here is the parameter which now is related to fluid mechanics. So this gives us a motivation of why should we study fluid dynamics for convective heat transfer. So when we say fluid dynamics, we have to keep in mind that fluid dynamics, to understand fluid dynamics, we need to understand basic equations of fluid mechanics. And what are the basic equations of fluid mechanics? The basic equations of fluid mechanics are the conservation equations, like conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, and in heat transfer you also have conservation of energy.